Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to another tutorial on PSIM. We are explaining the use of PSIM for various kind of power electronic devices in our previous videos. In this particular video, we will try to emphasize on the use of PSIM for simulating the DC to DC buck converter, the boost converter, and probably the buck boost converter. We should notice one thing that PSIM is a very handy software that is designed specifically for simulating the power electronic circuits, and therefore its use is very important for the practicing engineers and the students. So in the today's class, we will simulate a buck converter and a boost converter, and we will provide special emphasis on the use of PSIM to visualize what happens when we first start a particular DC to DC converter, and that we will visualize by inspecting the voltage across the inductor through the relationship that we studied in the basic electric circuits. So let us begin with the simulation of this DC to DC converter. So let us simulate the buck converter. I have placed this voltage source here. Thereafter, I require a switch. Let us use this particular switch. This is actually a MOSFET, and we will also use a diode. So the diode is placed here. This diode will be in this particular direction. We need to have an inductor, capacitor, and a resistance as a load. Apart from that, we like to see what is the current flowing in some of the components here. So let us see what is the current flowing through this particular inductor and the current that flows through this particular load. So let me draw. Let me put these things here as well. We also want to turn on this particular switch. So for that, I will use this clock signal here, this one. So that requires the ground node here, and we will connect this through this gating block. Otherwise, it will give us an error here. Now I need to put in the values. So let us first of all put the value for this particular frequency. Let the switching frequency be equal to 20 kilohertz. So I have put this 20 kilohertz. Also, we need to put the duty cycle equal to 0.4. What I'm trying here is I will try to step down a 50 volt supply to 20 volt. So because in a buck converter we have the transfer function that is equal to d times v of s. So if I make this d equal to 0.4, it will step down this 50 volt into 20 volts. For this resistance, the resistance is equal to 20 ohm. The output capacitor is, I will set it equal to 100 microfarad. These values are based on the design parameters. That is not the scope of this particular tutorial. We may go for the design procedure in some later tutorials. But right now, the main concern is to simulate this thing. So the inductance is equal to 400 microhenry, and that's it. So we need to put in some voltage probes here as well. So let us find out what is the input voltage and the output voltage. So this is, let me call it, this is VI and this is V naught. Call this V naught. Also, it is worth seeing the voltage across this particular inductor. So to find out the voltage across this inductor, I will place this voltage probe here. So we have this one. Let me call this V of L. Okay. Now you can see here, let me bold these particular waveforms so that they become more visible. So now you can see here, it is now much more visible. However, it has disturbed the view a little bit. So we have exactly 50 volt available for the V input, and this V naught is set at 20 volt by virtue of the duty cycle that what we have applied. The next thing that we want to see is the behavior of the inductor current and the inductor voltage. So let me remove these two, and I will draw IFL and the VFL. So now you can see here, because they are switching at a high frequency, so let me zoom it a little bit to see what happens in a zoom view. So now you can see here that whenever we have a positive voltage applied to this particular inductor, the current rises from some value, initial value, and it reaches to some final value. And after that, when we have a negative voltage applied to the inductor, the rate of change of current is negative. One thing that you should notice here is that this current is not touching this zero boundary, and therefore it is still in a continuous conduction mode. To ensure more about the continuous conduction mode, we may actually increase the value of the inductance here. Okay, let us move back and see what happens when we first start. I will draw these few cycles are very important. So now you can see, as soon as we turn on the switch, the positive voltage is applied to the inductor, and therefore the current rises in a constant ramp that is equal to L di over dt. So the voltage V of L is equal to L di over dt. So the rate of change of current is equal to V of L over L, and that is a constant. So current rises in a continuous slope till this particular point we turn off the switch. After that, we turn off the switch, the output current, the output voltage V naught, it is not much charged, and therefore the slope of the current V of L is equal to L di over dt. We do not have any slope here, because when the switch is turned off, we do not have any voltage available at the output V naught, and therefore this V naught is equal to zero. So di over dt become equal to zero. As you can see here, the slope is zero here. After that, we again turn on the supply, and some more current flows through this particular inductor, and the inductor charges at a subconstant rate till we turn on the switch. After that, you can see here, now we have a little bit of downslope here because of the availability of the output voltage, and this continues unless we have a continuous rise and fall of the inductor current, and this goes on with the sequence of this particular transient operation. After we have a stable output available, you can see here that the rise of current and the fall of current becomes equal for each switching cycle, and that is where the steady state condition actually reaches, as you can see here. So this is how we can actually visualize the inductor and the inductor voltage waveform and the inductor current waveform. Let us simulate another thing. We have plotted the I of C. So let us plot this one. So as you can see here, the I of C, which is the current through the capacitor, it contains all the AC ripples which are present in the inductor circuit, because that is the job of the capacitor to take away all the AC component which is present in the output. Contrary to that, if I may plot another waveform with I of R, you can see here this I of R is quite stable. You can see here this I of R is quite stable. It is because the capacitor is actually playing the role of filtration, and whatever the AC component is, I of C provides a smooth path for the AC ripple component to flow. However, by the property of the capacitor, the capacitive impedance, that is X of C is equal to 2 pi F into L, all the DC component is blocked by the capacitor, and therefore very little of the DC component flows through this capacitor owing to some of the practical non-idealities in it. So therefore this I of R is more or less smooth in case of our particular converter. Now we can also find out what is the peak to peak ripple for this I of C available here, and that is that we can always do by changing the design. And now let us simulate the boost converter. For this boost converter, I have placed the values for the inductance, that is equal to 120 microhenry. For this capacitor, that is equal to 48 microfarad. So let me make it 48 microfarad. The resistance is set to the same value. However, I will change the duty ratio here. Lock here, let me convert it to 0.5 and make it to 20k. So 20 kilohertz is okay. L is equal to 120 microfarad, it's set. Let me set the input voltage equal to 12 volt. So with this 0.6 value, let us see where we actually land with this particular thing. Now again, I would like to measure the voltage across the inductor and the current through the inductor, and also I would like to that's okay. So we just need to put in these two things here. Okay, so this is V of L, and let me call this one I of L, and let me simulate this thing. Now the first thing I need to measure is V naught and V of I. So again, you can see here that now this V of I is less than the V naught. So you can see here against this 12 volt, we are getting something around 30 volts. The important point here is that we may want to see is again the inductor current and the inductor voltage. So let us draw these two as well. Now as you can see here, the inductor waveform and the inductor voltage waveform and the current waveform, they show the textbook results as we see in the normal textbooks. Based on this particular thing, you can always find out what is the peak current flowing through the device, so that you can peak current flowing through the inductor, so that you can actually design and you can select the devices that you want to use. The second thing here is that the current is well above zero, so it is again in a continuous conduction mode. Now if I move back to this particular zero point, you can again see that we have the similar kind of a the behavior as we have witnessed in our previous simulation of a buck converter, that these rising and the falling slope depends entirely on the equations that we develop for the inductor current and the inductor voltage. So these waveforms can only be witnessed visually by either by using the experimentation and by going for the lengthy procedure, setting up the circuit and doing, you know, all the measurement stuff. In the simulation part, without undergoing that thing, we can visualize what is going on with the inductor current and the inductor voltage. Another thing important here is, as we have learned here, that the inductor voltage can instantaneously switch down. However, current requires a finite time. Inductor do not allow sudden change in the current. Another point here is, if I remove these one, and I want to show you what is the capacitor current here. So you can see again here that the capacitor current is actually a bidirectional current here. So you can see at the some time the capacitor is supplying the current, and sometimes the capacitor charges itself for the remaining period of time, and that it supplies to the load here. I hope that you have all understand what we have seen in the today's class, and this will help you in grasping the concepts of using softwares for power electronic circuits, and that will surely create an interest in your academia as well while you will study this particular course on power electronics. I hope you all a very good luck. Thank you very much.